Keep that in mind as you're living your life. It doesn't last long. Sandra Sue Lockwood, 74, of Crossett, passed away Saturday, February 13, 2021, at her home surrounded by her family and her special friend, Tony Gales. She was born in Bastrop, Louisiana on July 23, 1946, to her parents, Charles and Mary Jean Odenbaum Hassler. She was a former graduate of Bastrop High School and an active member of Rothschild Free Will Baptist Church. She was outgoing and often enjoyed playing the piano. She was genuinely devoted to her family, her church, and most importantly, to God. Sandra didn't just attend church, but taught Sunday school for many years, sung in the choir, and could always be depended on to help with Bible school. Her love for her children even led her to become a foster grandparent, with which she took great pride. Her prayer always included asking God to give her opportunities to witness to lost souls so that she could share the love of Jesus Christ. However, her health kept her calm. Her faith was so strong that she even saw her hospital stay as an answered prayer and tried to share the gospel with everyone she could. She is preceded in death by her parents and her husband of 54 years, Charlie Richwood Lockwood. Her survivors include one son, Daryl Lockwood, and wife, Joanna, one daughter, Carla Riles, all across it, along with one brother, Mike Hassler, and wife, Shirley, of West Monroe, Louisiana, and four grandchildren, Jacob Lockwood, wife, Allison, Jerry Lockwood, Caleb Taylor, Jerry Kendrick, and wife, Heather, and one special nephew, Scotty Lockwood, and wife, Angela. Sister Sandy made me promise that I would not talk about her. Now that's very unusual to say to someone that they're for their own funeral. And I said, okay, and I'm not a liar, all right? But I don't see one bit of problem myself, and I don't think she would either if I could talk to her again about using her for an example of what a Christian really ought to be.
Yeah, amen, amen.
I haven't found anyone who would deny the fact that this lady loved Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And all she wanted to do was talk about Jesus. And she told me, said, when you get up there, I want you to talk about my Jesus. So I'm going to talk about her Jesus. But you know, I've never seen Jesus. I don't know if any of you have. I saw a picture somebody drew. I don't even know if that's anywhere near accurate. But I believe that he lives today.
Yes, he does, Brother Douglas.
And I think I have seen Jesus. Because when I saw Sister Sandy, I saw Jesus. You know, every Christian ought to be like that. They ought to see Jesus in you. All the time. All the time.
They should.
And I hope to not be like I say I'm not, but you never know. But I want to read to you a few scriptures out of Matthew chapter 5, starting verse 13. He says, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt hath lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden underfoot of men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. The key here is good works. We try to think of good works as going to church, paying my tithe, whatever it is that you might have listed, you know. Said to herself, she came to church all the time, sung in the choir. Well, I guess those people qualify as good works. But the good works that people do is that part that really glorifies Christ in their life. And I think this is what she did in a very special way to me. And she would always ask somebody, do you go to church? And they told her that, yeah, I go to church, or they'd say, they'd say, I love the Lord, I'm a Christian or whatever. But if they didn't go to church, it was confusing to her. Because how could anyone who's a Christian not go to church in her book? So she would invite them to come to hers. So, if you tell somebody you're saved and don't at least go to church, are you really living the life that Jesus Christ would have you live? Are you glorifying Him? But Sister Sandy knew Hebrews 9:27, which says, it's appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. Everybody is coming to this point in their life. All of you out there, myself included, are going to one day be lying out in death. And then the Bible tells us we're going to have to stand before God and give an answer. The Lord Himself said over in the 25th chapter of Matthew, said, when the Son of Man shall come in His glory and the holy angels with Him, that He shall sit upon the throne of His glory, and before Him shall be gathered all nations, and He shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divides the sheep from the goats. And He shall set the sheep on His right hand, and the goats on His left. Then shall the king say unto them on His right hand, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came unto me. They said, when in the world did we do these things? You ever thought about it? When in the world could you have done that for God to glorify Him? He just simply said, and verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. Just to bless someone's heart, you have pleased God in a special way. But then He shall say also to them on His left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no meat. I was thirsty, you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you took me not in. Naked, and you clothed me not. Sick, and in prison, and you visited me not. Then shall they also answer Him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee hunger, or thirst, or stranger, naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not minister unto thee? Then shall He answer them, saying, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you did it not unto the least of one of these, you did it not to me. And these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into everlasting life. You know, Jesus didn't make a list of things that everybody's got to do. You say, well, you mean I've got to go and visit and feed and dress them and go to prison? You know, in the Bible you'll find out that a lot of things are given as gifts that Christians have. Well, nobody has all the gifts and nobody does everything. But as you live your life, you will do things that are on that list. You will be things that are on that list. And when He's talking about these things, it simply means that when you see someone who has a need and you supply that need, then you have done it unto him. Especially if they too are a child of God. But if you don't do anything for the people around you, you don't reach out to them, you don't bless them, then you have come short of the glory of God. Sister Sandy would lay it, and she was so sick ever since I've known her. I've been around her for over 10 years now, and she's been sick the whole time, it seems like. And so the best time I ever got to visit was in the hospital. And when I got in there, she said, well, I was just sitting around the house, and I didn't feel like going anywhere or doing anything. So I just asked the Lord, would you please let me witness to somebody? Next thing I know, I'm in the hospital. So guess what she did?
Yep.
I met some of these people that told me. All she did was talk to them about the Lord and invite them to come to church. That was Sister Sandy. That is Jesus. That is Jesus. It's not easy to do. I know that she suffered a lot. I just had a little hospital stint myself, and you know, I sure didn't feel like blessing those people who were treating me so bad. You know, when Jesus shines in you, lives in your heart, he's going to come out, and you're going to be able to be a witness. And not only to be able, you have a desire to be a witness all the time, no matter what the conditions are. A person who doesn't know Christ seems to be more concerned with pleasing herself rather than sacrificing to meet the needs of others. They often wonder, why don't somebody do more for me? And so they're bitter. The Lord also spoke to the Apostle Paul when he was talking about the characteristics of a person who is a child of God. He said, it's so good that you have heard of him and been taught by him, talking about Jesus, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning the former conversation of the old man. That's that person that you were in your life when you were in sin. That behavior you had before you came to Jesus. He said, you should just put off of that behavior. You should not live that life anymore because it's not a part of who you are. You are a part of the kingdom of God now, he says. He says, you should put on the new man. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind. And that which is in God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Wherefore, put away lying. Speak every man truth with his neighbor. For we're members one of another. Be you angry and sin not. That's not retaliation, is it? You can be angry, sure. But get over it. Alright? Don't let the sun go down upon your wrath, he says. Don't give place to the devil. Satan wants you to go to hell. He doesn't want you to go to heaven. He will convince you that the way you're living is okay when God says it's not. He will talk you into convincing yourself that you're okay when all of a sudden you know inside you're not.
You're not.
You haven't been living for him. You know God's not pleased with you because you really have been just living for yourself and not someone else. He says, let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hand the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the heathen, the hearers, even. You know, people often say, well, I don't think these words are bad, or that I shouldn't say this or that. You know, it's not about words. You've always heard growing up that your mom would always tell you, if you had to have something nice to say, don't say anything at all. If you speak and it is not a blessing to others, then you have corrupt communication coming out of your mouth. God said, this is not the behavior of a child of God. We constantly war against the flesh that Satan wants to use to cause people to go away from God. He wants you to be lost for a minute. But Jesus says, I will show you a better way. Follow after Christ and you'll find yourself living a better way. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit, he says, because you've been sealed in the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. I have found that the most dangerous thing that a person does, excuse me, let me put it like this, a person who believes they're a Christian, even a person who is a Christian, most dangerous thing that we've got in our life that we have trouble getting over is we cannot forgive others.
Amen.
Tell me, did you deserve for Jesus Christ to go to the cross and die for you? Die in your place. He took your sins upon him. And he says, I'm going to give you the power to never sin again. And he went to the cross and he died. He never asked that you, apologize. He never asked you to start being good. While you were still a sinner, we read over in Romans chapter 5 and verse 8, it says, while we were still sinners, he demonstrated his love to us by going to the cross. And he said, now do it to the least of these out here. Forgive them for nothing, not because they apologize, not because they ask for it. Forgive them. Because if you can't forgive them, then I can't forgive you. And that bitterness will drag you down to the pits of hell.
Amen.
And you'll stand before God one day in that judgment. Remember, I told you, we're all going to stand before God one day. And the Lord's going to say, why should I let you into my heaven? You never forgave. You kept living for yourself. You didn't meet the deeds. He said, you didn't visit them when they were sick and in prison. You didn't check them out when they needed help. All you thought about was yourself. But Lord, I made that profession one day. You know, just like the words of your mouth can send you to hell, the words of your mouth cannot save you. It takes action. To get rid of the things that are dragging us down to hell, we have to give them to God. Die to that old person and be made new all again. I don't know if Sister Sandy was ever bad in her life. Having met her, I wouldn't believe that she ever, ever talked back to her mom. But I know the nature of human people, all right? And I'll just bet you she did a lot of things that were pretty naughty in her life. And if you've known her for a long time, you'd probably say, well, I know some things she did. I heard her say some things. You may think of all kinds of negative stuff. You know why you try to think about those kind of things? It's to make you feel better because you're no good. And you want to think, like, you think she was so good and wonderful. I heard some things. I know some things you don't know. Remember, we're all warring against the flesh. And the flesh is going to make us react wrong. But I would just bet from my visitation with her that she never went to sleep at night before she asked God to forgive her if I failed today. She was that kind of a person.
Yes.
Because she loved God. And she wants all of you to love God. She wants you to show the grace of God in your life. And, you know, being a preacher, sometimes people don't show their real self to me. But I tell you what, when they're laying there hurting in a hospital bed, the real self is going to come out.
Yeah.
Always. And she never let God down. Jesus never did live for himself. And neither should we. He says that if you would confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you can be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Have you given your heart to Jesus Christ today? There's nothing that would make her happy, happier than what she already is right now. She's pretty darn happy. But what would make her happier is if you couldn't stand to have any time to wait. If you just came right now and knelt down here, we'll just stop everything we're doing and we'll let God come and change your life. Don't be afraid to do that even now. But please, give your life to Jesus. If you have any good thoughts for her, that's what her heart was breaking over the last time I spoke to her. Well, maybe not the last time. She wasn't really all there. We had to pray real quick before she left and just went to sleep. But the day before I spoke to her, she was concerned about the people around her that she wasn't sure as to whether they were Christians or not. That's what was on her mind. world is what was going on with other people. Tell you, that's what God's looking for. Somebody just wants to glorify Him in their life. But don't lose hope, okay? Certainly don't lose hope for her. I found, since my parents passed, or it probably crossed my mind before that, when I go out to a cemetery, I think of that body lying down there in the ground, 6 feet under me. And you know, that can be a pretty discouraging thought. But I want you to know that this body that we live in is just a temporary vessel that God had us to abide in here for a little while. But one day, He's going to change that body. You've heard that the graves are going to burst open?
Mm-hmm.
It's not true. Oh, I don't mean to bust your bubble, all right? But when the angels rolled that stone away from Jesus' tomb, He was already gone. His whole body had been transformed into a glorified body, fit to live in glory before God, in total perfection, no corruption. And it went right through the walls of that tomb. Just like He came through the walls into the room when the disciples were gathered there. It's a special body. And apparently it looks just like the former body. She's lucky. She was awfully pretty. I didn't even really know how pretty until I saw those pictures. Very pretty. And Carla, a couple of times there, I thought it was a picture of you. And then I said, no, it was her. You are a physical embodiment of your mother. She wants you to be a spiritual embodiment of who she is too. Just like she wants each and every one of you. So, over in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, I don't want to let this slide. It said, I wouldn't have you be ignorant, brother, concerning them which are asleep,
amen,
that you sorrow not, even as others which are in have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them which die, excuse me, let me read the word right, even so them which also sleep in Jesus will God bring with Him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. In other words, we're not going to precede them. Alright? You're not going to get called up. If the Lord comes back before you die, you're not going to go up the sky to meet the Lord, because you see, when He comes back, He's going to come back with all the folks in heaven. All of them. I believe all those spirits, this is my belief, that they're all going to be there with Him in the clouds. Alright? But that was their spiritual essence that has ascended, just like Sister Sandy's spiritual essence is already in the presence of God right now. Okay? But they're going to come back in the air. But before we ever leave the ground, and it all happens in a twinkling of an eye, it says, they're going to come up out of those graves. No, you can go sit in the graveyard and you might not know what's happening. Because you see, that body is going to be transformed into a spiritual body, and it's going to go up and they're going to be reunited with their spiritual essence. And this is what I call it, right? In the sky. And when you get there, they're going to already have their new body before you ever got yours. That's what he's saying right here. He said, the Lord shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Forever and ever, going into that home that He promised to each one who lives for Him. Many are not going to make it. Many of your fellow church members are not going to make it. Sister Sandy was concerned about this, and so am I, and so does every Christian we know. Is your heart right with God? Not according to my standards, but according to God's standards. One day, we're going to all be raised up together to be with the Lord, those who have lived like Jesus. That people see you that light that is set on the hill, it can't be hidden from anybody because everybody's going to see it. That light, that glorious light, does the light of Jesus Christ shine in you? Pray with me, please. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you that you were willing to make the supreme sacrifice of sending down your Son from his realm of glory into the presence of all of us here on earth. He lived that life to show us that we could live for you. And Lord, we know that we will live for you through the Holy Spirit who comes to speak to our heart and guide us. I pray, dear Lord, today that you'll speak to hearts here that we have already searched ourselves and said, you know, am I coming up to the standard that's required to go to heaven? I know that what Sister Sandy wanted for each person to be ready to meet God. Lord, I believe with all my heart that she's with you. I'm no judge of men. You know men's hearts, just like you know each of ours. But Lord, I pray that you would help us to have that peace that passes all understanding. And Lord, today I pray that you comfort our hearts to know that one day, if we live for you as you want us to, that we'll be able to be reunited with this dear sister and every other saint that has gone before. I pray, dear Lord, today that you comfort this family. Give them joy in their hearts every time they remember her.